either in the sanctuary, online, or later this evening on our local cable channel. We're very grateful for those connections, and we hope that you feel as close to us as we feel as close to you during these strange, wonderful times that we live in. We're continuing this format, and we'll continue online going forward as well. So we hope to live into that ministry, and so we look forward to some new updates coming soon so that we can make that a more full-body online experience as well. Our announcements this week. We're continuing our sermon series called Our Stories. Today's theme is release. We talked today about a little more of our past and our present and what we're going to be doing going forward. If you're on our mailing list, you received your 2020 year-end review letter this week. You also in it received your 2021 pledge cards. They may look a little different than anything you've ever had here before, but we're asking that you tell us what your time, talents, and treasures are so that we can plug you into the ministries here at First Presbyterian Church and in our community, and so that we can better plan for 2021. Now with that, just so that everyone is assured, where it does have you place your pledge, if you wish to do that, that will go to Lori Phillips Jones, who is our new reporting treasurer. She's taking over from Mike, from Miss Joyce. I believe Miss Kathy's done it. We have a long line of trusted treasurers who do that work for us. She will receive this, record it, and then black that area out with magic marker. And then your time and talents will come to myself and the worship team so we can start looking at our 2021 worship and our opportunities that we want to live into this coming year. So very exciting times around that. You will also notice that our table here in the front has been reset. You'll notice that there are currently burning six candles, one for each life that we have lost here in Scott County to COVID-19, and a large one for the lives that we do not know of in our community, in our country, in our world. And so we'll continue to light those. If you have a loved one that you would like a candle lit for who is experiencing that or has passed from COVID, please let us know. We'll be happy to add a candle in their memory as we keep that vigil here at First Presbyterian Church. Our adult and children's Sunday school is going great, and so we're looking forward to all that that is bringing us. We will start on November 15th, 22nd, and 29th, receiving our special offering to the Unicorn Fund. I know, I saw Ava jump up. We will need some unicorns to help take up that offering. Can I get a thumbs up? So I know I'll have several unicorns that will be helping us on that. Are there any other announcements this morning before we move into our call to worship? Actually have one. Rainbow Girls is also having their fundraiser. The cons are found in the fellowship hall. So I know those are a big highlight of my year, and so I hope it's yours too. So those are in there, and Lori will be taking care of that. Let us stand now and join together in our call to worship. Through Moses, God said, "Let my people go." In Scripture, the law declares, in the seventh year, you must cancel all debts. With grace, Jesus said, give one coat away. With honesty, Jesus taught, sell what you have and give that money to the poor. Faith has always involved letting go, releasing, setting free, dropping our nets, giving to others, and following. So in this hour of worship, may we release that which binds us. May we worship with open, untamed, and porous hearts so that we can walk freely with God. Let it be so. Amen. May be seated. Thank you. ask, O God, that you will let us release all those things that are holding us back, keeping us from being who you want us to be. We ask, O God, that you will touch the brokenhearted. Calm the nerves and minds of this great country. We ask, O God, that you will help us come together in this hour, laying aside all that would separate us, to embrace all that unites us. For it is the faith of Jesus Christ and the grace of God freely given that we choose above all things to humbly walk with you, O God, this day and every day. Amen. Hear the prayers of our community for those who have lost loved ones and those who are suffering. Ms. Veronica has an unspoken request for our community members, so please be in prayer. Ms. Ava had a prayer request this morning. We're still holding that tight as well. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, prayer. Prayer for one another. Prayer for those we know and those we don't know. What a gift. A gift and a blessing to be able to call out the names of those who are on our hearts. And we know, O God, that for every prayer that is spoken, there are hundreds more that live in our hearts that we may never be bold enough to let cross our lips. But we know, God, you who knows every hair of our head, every breath that we take, that those prayers are already held in your loving arms. We ask, God, that you watch over our veterans as we celebrate Veterans Day this week, that you will watch over all of our first responders, those who keep us safe, those who heal our bodies, those who you are giving the knowledge flowing freely to find a way out of this pandemic. We ask, O God, that you hold us all close, that you calm our souls and our hearts, that you will sit with us in our sadness and in our joy, in our fear, in our excitement, in all of our emotions. For our emotions are what let us know that we are connected to you, O God. And we ask that you keep us humble and that you free us, allow us to release and let go of all those things holding us back, so that when we pray as you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. grateful for?
Well, wow, that's pretty good.
I was afraid that it would be an attitude adjustment box. That would be my box, but no.
I'm so glad it's an attitude of gratitude box.
And some of you got notebooks to write down what you're grateful for in. And Miss Nikki shared that she already keeps one, so that's pretty special. So I'm so excited for you. You know what I'm grateful for? Each and every one of you. Do you know why? She's giving me the look. I'm grateful for each and every one of you because at one time, I want you to look out here. You see all these people sitting out here? Do you know what? At some point, they were just like you? Yeah. They were sitting there in Sunday morning talking to a pastor going, what can I do when I grow up? So I am grateful that I get to see all the amazing things that you're going to do. And an amazing thing you're going to get to do in church, in school, all over, so that when you're like these folks here, your kids and grandkids will be sitting here going, wait, you sat here too? And that's a pretty big deal. To me, that's something to really, really be grateful for. Because each and every one of you, in the lessons that each and every one of you teach us, every day. So that's what I am grateful for. And honestly, I don't know, Angela, that's going to take a pretty big box. Lots of boxes. Let's pray. Will you pray with us? Let's all pray together, okay? Dear God.
Dear God.
Thank you for attitudes of gratitude.
Thank you for attitudes of gratitude.
Thank you for everyone who sit where we sit.
Thank you for everyone who sits where we sit.
And for everyone who will sit where we're sitting right now.
And for everyone who will sit where we're sitting right now.
Help us be grateful for them.
Help us to be grateful for them.
And help them to be grateful for us. Amen.
Of your community owes you.
among you, because the Lord is sure to bless you in the land that the Lord your God is giving you as a possession to occupy. If only you will obey the Lord your God by diligently observing this entire commandment that I command you today. When the Lord your God has blessed you and he promised you, you will lend to many nations, but you will not borrow. You will rule over many nations, but you will not let them rule over you. If there is among you anyone in need, a member of your community, in any of your towns within the land that your Lord God is giving you, do not be hard-hearted or tight-fisted toward your needy neighbor. You should rather open your mind, willingly lending enough to meet the need, whatever it may be. Be careful that you do not entertain a mean thought, thinking the seventh year, the year of remission, is near, and therefore view your needy neighbor with hostility and give nothing. Your neighbor might cry to the Lord against you, and you would incur guilt. Give liberally and be unjudging when you do so. For on this account, the Lord your God will bless you in all your work and in that you undertake, since there will never cease to be some in need on the earth. I therefore command you, open your hand to the poor and needy neighbor in your land. Holy wisdom, holy word. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Teacher, what good deed must I do to have eternal life? And he said to him, Why do you ask me about what is good? There is only one who is good. If you wish to enter into life, keep the commandments. And he said to him, Which ones? And Jesus said, You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness. Honor your father and your mother. Also, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. The young man said to him, I have kept all these. What do I still lack? Jesus said to him, If you wish to be perfect, go sell your possessions and give the money to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come, follow me. When the young man heard this word, he went away grieving, for he had many possessions. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. How fitting is it that this Sunday morning we are discussing release and letting go of things that are holding us back. That's the interesting part about selecting a sermon series a month or so in advance, is that oftentimes it is what God wants you to hear and not what you may have chosen yourself. So let's turn to Scripture and see what Scripture tells us about letting go. Our Old Testament reading this morning is about the sabbatical year. As God, after forming creation, saw that it was good, on the seventh day he rested. He took Sabbath time to look on creation and to rest, to let go of the work and to be with creation. Sabbath leads from the word sabbatical, a year of rest, forgiveness, of letting go and allowing community to recover from 6 years of earthly living. A time when debts were forgiven in the community, land was restored to its original owners, and healing could occur. If you were in service, you knew that you would be released from that service. This was not a rolling calendar year where everyone had a separate start and stop date. No, this was an entire community doing this together. 6 years they labored, and then on the seventh year, they forgave, reset their entire community back to a godly way, a way where everyone was fed, a way where community was healthy because they took time to release all that was stopping them from living the life that God called them and us to live today. Forgiving each is a form of release. Caring for those in our community and our land is a form of release. We have to release things that are holding us back, giving us anxiety and stress, so that we can be open to helping those in need. Verses 10 through 11 says, Give liberally and ungrudging when you do so. For on this account, the Lord your God will bless you in all your work and in all that you undertake. Since there will never cease to be some in this earth. Therefore, I command you, open your hand to the poor and needy neighbor in your land. Open your hand to the poor. Perhaps that hand has food, clothes, help to find shelter. Maybe it's just a hand outstretched in greeting. Perhaps that open hand is a sign of dignity that a person has not experienced in a really long time. Perhaps it's an open hand giving to someone you know will provide a service in your community. This hand should always be a hand of friendship, community, a hand of love, because we never know when we will be the one needing that hand of hope for ourselves. Our New Testament reading in the Gospel of Matthew this morning also deals with letting go and release. We have a written rich young man who comes to Jesus asking him what good deed he must do to have eternal life. Jesus reviews the law with him, and the young man tells him that yes, he follows all of these things. So if he follows all of these things, he then asks Jesus, what do I still lack? How about faith in the Lord? The young man is told to sell everything and give it to the poor. Then come back and follow Jesus. Faith is hard. And faith often requires releasing things that are holding us back in order to walk closer with God. Let's pause just for a moment and think about that young man. Well, he's doing everything according to the law. Or is he? Is he feeding the poor? Is he clothing the stranger and caring for the widow and orphan? Or is he storing up riches on the earth? Well, we don't really know. But we do know that Jesus tells him to sell everything, give the money to the poor, and to follow him. Perhaps this young man had filled his storehouses to the brim and built more to ensure that his wealth would continue. Perhaps, like the people of faith in the story of the Good Samaritan, he crossed the street instead of becoming unclean and helping someone in need. Perhaps he followed the law so closely that he had become blind to all of God's creation. We don't know, but we do know that we are being called into a different way of thinking, a different way of community. So if we're being called into a different way of community, what is holding us back? What is getting in our way? I want to read you a quote this morning. See if you know where it comes from. I am a fortunate man in many ways, but I'm most fortunate in having a hobby that has stayed with me all my life. It's a great saving grace. It permits me to relieve my anxieties and to escape from the frustrations or disappointment or even the exhilarations of the moment. Photography gives me an opportunity to reestablish fresh perspectives. Does anyone know who wrote this? There's one person. Oh, there's a couple. Senator Howard Baker Jr. wrote that statement. These are the words that he chose to open his book, Howard Baker to Washington. The words that tell the honest truth that even our favorite native son experienced anxieties, needed to escape from the frustrations, disappointments, and exhilarations of the moment, to reestablish a fresh perspective, getting a different angle on an issue, letting go of one view, and through another, finding a way of looking at something a little different. For me, it's getting out of my books and from behind my desk, and sometimes just sitting on the floor with a dry erase board. For Senator Baker, it's taking photographs and spending time in his beloved hometown. Last week, we talked about our stories and how our founding fathers and mothers laid the groundwork that we worship on today. We must also remember the men and women who came later, who gave their time, talents, and their treasures so that we would continue to have a place to worship long, long, long after they were gone. Those still with us, and those who have crossed over, those who had the forethought to establish a trust to ensure First Presbyterian Church could be here long after they were gone, those who labor week after week making sure the needs of the community are met through endless hours and whose talents we witness every time we meet in worship. We are called to a new way of living through Jesus Christ. We must pause and remember that we are a community of many, with many gifts and many ways of participating in the life of the church. We must take a pause and think about those whose labors and whose shoulders we have stood on for too long. Just like in Deuteronomy, communities need to rest, and people need to rest. In order to allow rest, well, new leaders have to be willing to pick up the mantle and share the load, to enliven a community with their time, their talents, and treasures. This is no small task, because like all children, we know that it is easier to let our elders do the work until we are forced to do it for ourselves. We cannot take your work for granted, and we must be willing to say, I think I can take on that role. I could lead a small group or a Bible study. I could lead a community hike or teach a Sunday school class or set up a Zoom Bible study or any number of things. We all have things that hold us back from stepping out into what God wants us to do. Maybe you're tired, maybe you've tried before, maybe you've received negative feedback, or even no feedback at all. What if the person who is doing the job does it so well, and they do it a very specific way that we're afraid if we do it differently, we'll ruin it for everything and everyone? What if we have a new idea and know it's never been done that way before? And what if we make a proposal? What if we get told no? Life is filled with a lot of what ifs. They cause us anxiety, stress, and fear. This will never go away. This is normal. We all have things that hold us back from stepping out fully into God's call. Maybe it's death, wealth, fear of the unknown, fear of failing, fear of success. So much fear that we never even try. We live our lives following the rules and forget that we follow Jesus. Well, Jesus showed us how to turn all of the rules on their side. Jesus, who says, have faith and walk with me. Give up what is holding you back and follow me. Give your community a break and help carry the load so that the backs of our elders can rest. Let go of the things that are holding you back from supporting your community. Give your time. Give your talents. And if possible, your treasures. Listen to the wisdom of Senator Baker and re-establish a fresh perspective. Be a Miss Hembury, a Byrd or Ernie, a Senator Baker, a Carol Purdy, a Henry Durant, or the saints right now who are carrying so much load. Look at those that you admire. Look at those around you that you think, wow, we're doing a great job. Would they like some help? Can I do that? Like our scripture tells us, let go of the things that are holding you back from walking closer with God. Be brave. Be bold. Find a release for your anxiety and fear and step out in faith. The beauty of a community of faith like First Presbyterian Church is we will be right there with you. Each person who came before us stood in this very same place. They had to release what was holding them back. They had to let go. They had to step up. They had to become the church so that the church could become the church in the world. As a community, we can all look at our time, our talents and treasures, and together we can continue to build our community so that we can better serve the larger God-created community around us. Time, talents, and treasures Help us to express our desire to walk closer to God, to be more like Jesus, to feed the hungry, to clothe the needy, care for the widow, the orphan, and the stranger, and to forgive one another, and allow for rest, so that when our children and grandchildren look back on our time at First Presbyterian Church, it will be your names they lift up as an example of how to walk closer to God. God's grace, freely given, calls us to do better, to be better than we were yesterday, so that as we strive to walk humbly with God, we learn from our past, live into our present, and dream of our future. All thanks and glory be to our living God. Amen. Let us stand now for our affirmation of faith. We believe that on the first day, God released love and creativity over a void, and that void became mountains and rivers, sunsets and starry nights. We believe God released God's people from the grips of slavery, liberating us day in and day out. We walk humbly